call this meeting to order. I'll ask that Mr. Etheridge lead us in our invocation and our pledge this morning.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and for our opportunity for us to come together to work for the education of students in Bibi County. We ask that you bless this meeting today, guide and direct us in the work that we do this morning. Ask all the saints in Jesus' name.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Everybody's had a chance to look over our agenda. Unless there are any changes, I'll accept a motion to adopt the agenda.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. There are no objections. We'll pass this by general consent. Seeing none. Agenda is adopted. I'd like to take this time to welcome any visitors that would like to come speak at this time. I remind all those visitors out there that you have 5 minutes to address the board. You got anything today?
I just had a question. Is the company that wants to buy the Wilson High School, are they still interested in buying Wilson High School, or they lost the interest?
Yes, sir.
Okay. They have exercised their option to out of the contract.
Yeah, I know that. Is it why?
No, sir. They don't have to. They just sent us a notification that they're exiting the contract.
They're not back on the market?
Yes, sir.
Is it just short letters? Can I get a copy of that?
And we will accept an offer from you for it.
About that kind of money wouldn't be checked.
Has there been some lobby reporter in that building?
I don't see any public comments on the agenda.
That's what this is, public comment. And throughout the meeting.
Visitors.
Pardon?
The welcome visitor section.
The substitutes for public comment. Oh, that is public comment.
It's just a friendly way of saying you're welcome here, and if you have anything you'd like to address the board, that's, it all gets wrapped together.
We're the friendly board.
You are?
I like to think so.
Is that a question?
That was a comment.
I am.
All right, anything else? Mr. Weber back there for?
No, sir, I got this.
All right, we're gonna ask our superintendent to address us at this time.
Mr. Weber couldn't be here today. He is actually at a state schools meeting where the state school director is going to be up today. He's going to be there. And so that meeting, that schedule on top of this one. So what I have, you have in front of you is, first off, let me tell you what's going to come next agenda. Next agenda, we're going to meet an executive session to review the different plans that from the schools, the state school plans, and that we're submitting in the district plan. That has to be board approved, and since they're talking about individual school security stuff, that will be an executive session. Okay? But here is an overview of the best practices and things to review that the district has gone through. In efficiency and effectiveness of the overall view of the district plan and what the school is doing. And Deputy Keith Osteen is in the house right there, and everything that we do is in cooperation with the school board or with the sheriff's office. And so you can take a few minutes to look through this. And if you have any questions, comments. One of the big things that's available this year is that through the mental health allocation, we hired Dr. Pratt, who is a school psychologist. And I know her caseload is rather large. I mean, I'll drop the ball talking up today. But that is a new service that the school district is providing.
So, Dr. Hall, or maybe you answer this, is she visiting on a regular schedule to each of our schools, or is it on
right
a
now? She's case? Working the entire district because we still have some positions to still fill.
Okay.
She has a caseload currently of 48, and she's touch base with every school. But the goal is for her to be focused to be Williston Middle High School, the Williston community, and Yankee Town. When we hire some additional staff, they'll take care of Bronson, Chiefland, and Cedar Keeper. Right now, Dr. Pratt is covering the entire district. And she has a caseload of 48 students that have been identified, of needing some extra layer of additional support. Mental health is her area of specialty. So she's done a wonderful job in a short window of time that she's been with us.
And what's the procedure or process when we identify those students?
So we have a form whereby the teacher or anyone on the staff can refer a student, and there's a, what do you call it?
Checklist.
It's a checklist, but it's a flow chart that shows exactly what the steps are. So there's a team that convene, there's some risk factors that we ask teachers to identify. The adults meet, Dr. Pratt is part of that conversation, and or our one school social worker. That's another position that we need to fill that I've been interviewing for. And they decide on next steps, and next steps can be the school council provide interventions, or if it's an additional support that needs to happen, that's where Dr. Pratt comes into play. Because her role is to ask and provide additional support that we're not already providing. The law is very clear that we can't supplant services. Or if we need to reach out to the community agency, and we've done that in a couple of students already, where they come in and they provide support at school and or in the home.
Okay. So though, can you send us that flow chart?
Yes.
That would be great.
Uh-huh.
Because I'm being asked about those services specifically in Cedar Key, and if there's a student and trying to protect privacy here, if they've been identified, what partners, is that Meridian?
It could be Meridian at the table, it could be Children's Home Society.
Okay.
Our SETNET coordinator, Liz, that's part of her role responsibility under SETNET, that's okay. In statute, to reach out to various agencies, to come and sit and talk with us about services for children.
I mean, doesn't Jonathan, I'm not putting on the spot.
He's listed as one of our agency collaborators. Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
So there should be no child on the press, because there is a process that Dr. Pratt has shared with the administration and the school counselor.
Okay, so when we identify these partners, and I'm just gonna use Meridian for an example, we've had situations with them where the student had an appointment in Chiefland and then they were sent all the way to Lake City from Cedar Key. So we may need to revisit and research, and I'm probably gonna need to lean on you to get some help in this process, because number one, I can't imagine someone having to travel from Cedar Key to Lake City. So, but number two, showing up to an appointment and then making that trip all the way to Lake City and then being told, I'm sorry, we can't see you today.
Yeah, that shouldn't happen.
So.
And we can't address unless we know
that. That's
so glad you brought to my attention.
We need to know, because we meet
yes,
with
do.
Those, is it monthly?
Yes.
We meet with all providers.
Gotcha.
Yeah, that's through the...
And we're having regional meetings, Tri-County in Chiefland. We had our first one about 3 weeks ago, and all these service providers are at those meetings. We talk about barriers, we talk about our experiences,
right.
We talk about what our expectations are. So this is the first I've heard of that you've shared.
That's one of the things in the statute is the sharing of information and cooperation.
And this came to my attention late Friday, so it's relatively fresh, but it's, anyway, so that's why I was glad.
And one of the things we need to put in place is that who to call.
Right.
Because when that happened at Cedar Key, the administration and the school council didn't know exactly who to reach out to, and I have not heard this before, so I'm definitely glad to hear it.
Very much so. Appreciate it.
Sure. Are you hiring a psychologist for every school?
No, sir. We have a license. Dr. Pratt is our licensed school psychologist, and so my goal is to hire a licensed mental health counselor, too, and that would give us 3 additional staff members that we haven't had before. Our data in our district says that we need additional support, and having just one person is not sufficient at this time. That's my goal. And if I'm not able to find, I've been interviewing for months now, and it's just not enough of those practitioners that we need for the state, because everyone's going to be the same personnel in the state of Florida. So we may have to resort to contracting for services as a last resort. And many of our other chiefs are, they're contracting with other entities to ensure that they have staff on board when needed. So that's the one.
They have a big system we have to put all the information through. There's the FSAP, Florida School Safety Threat Assessment.
Yeah, Safe Schools Assessment Tool is what it's been for.
In old PERM language, remember the APAGA report we have to do every year? It's the APAGA report that has to be done for district-wide, and it has to be done for each school. Okay, and that's the report that's generated to the information that we have.
How from what we disseminated regarding each school?
Yes, sir.
What we compiled is?
Yes, sir.
What's our timeline on the grant process for Harden?
I have that question.
Hardening of our schools.
I think it's in the, I think the money gets released in January. Okay. I know we have to have by the end of October the district plan. The district plan, that's some of the stuff that you're going to be going over and when you go about the plans and what we can do. And again, our allocation. Our portion of the allocation is $192,000.
Do you want to do the charge number?
$192,000 out of the $67 million.
So leave that also because the charter schools at 192.
Yes,
so
that's for each camp.
For us,
they get their
proportion.
And that total, see if I have it here.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, $97 million. As opposed to take allocation.
Yes, that's number 7. Do we have, does each school have copies of these form plans or blueprints?
Yes, sir. That's something that we have to, again, now this is not necessarily your full blown blueprint. The object here is does the sheriff's office and the fire department know how to get around that school? Do they know what all the buildings and rooms are?
Okay.
And but we have to certify that to the auditors.
Yes, but that is available, maybe not, as you said. But that document, plan, and specification is available at each school site.
Well, the important thing for the audit purpose is that the first responders have that. That's.
As I see it, there's a time factor involved in there from a first responder being somewhere. An emergency happened at the school, they, you know, in a rush to get to the school, which may not be 2-3 blocks away, 2-3 miles away, and all of a sudden the plans are still elsewhere.
You know, they're all the sheriff's department, police departments, and fire departments have a couple of them.
Yeah, maybe I'm not explaining that.
All the schools are out.
He's not on the campus.
Yes,
and there is an emergency. Okay? Does he have that document in his pocket? Or is it at the school?
Do you want to?
I have Bronson High School blueprints on my computer.
Okay.
In an email form so I can pull it up anywhere I'm at.
Do all the other SROs have
that? That I'm not sure about. I know I got that from my school. I got that from Miss Allen. And I put it in, I have a file of aerial photos, school maps, like the little maps they give you out. When you get there, and Lou Brown.
I know I've been told that the sheriff's department, they have them on their computers. So any room deputy comes up and go over.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I was just going to say, maybe it would be good for us just to follow up on that and confirm that they have the access to be able to shoot it. So if it's not the SRO, so whoever it may be, they have capabilities of either pulling up on their road laptop or phone.
Again, that's a question we've had to answer, that specific question to the auditor that they have to answer. So they have been, everything's been confirmed by school, but they have that access.
And just a reminder, you mean access to this to the property, these are not public records. There's a specific exception, including classroom emergency checklists of what teachers are going to do in particular situations. I think we need to make sure that those are accessible to our teachers, but they're not posted in the classroom available for anybody to see.
Thank you. Any further questions?
That's just simple information.
Thank you, sir. Can I ask, SRO Keith Eschstein to come address this? Something interesting.
Good morning. Ms. Braswell, I see that you're going to share some things we're doing at Lawrenceville High School. Some of the things we're sharing, I'm sharing with they are not, they don't necessarily work on every campus because not all campuses are laid out the same, but for the sake of Lawrenceville High School, this is what we're going to speak about directly this morning. The way that Lawrenceville High School is set up, there are no bathrooms inside of the classrooms. You have to go out into the hallways to the game bathrooms if you need to go to the restroom. But during a critical incident, whether it be a school tax meeting or in a lockdown, or for the sheltering in place because of a chemical spill out on the highway, we're going to be stuck in a room for an extended period of time, we have to be able to continue to function normally. I mean, that's not going to be normal. We have to be able to do things normally. So we came up with this idea called the bucket. And basically, the bucket is a bucket full of supplies that you're going to need for the classroom. Now, in our bucket, I give a list to the board members of things that we have in here. But the main purpose of the bucket itself is, if you take a 5-gallon bucket and you put it in the corner of your classroom, you put your little cat litter in the bottom of it. If you have a pool noodle, you can make it fit around the rim of the bucket. It becomes a portable tool. So you have that in the corner, then you take a shower curtain and you go from one corner to the other. So now you have privacy in the bucket for people to use if they have to use the restroom. Now inside the bucket, we have hand sanitizer. We have disinfectant wipes, Lysol spray, toilet paper, of course. We keep some water, some maybe little cups, so you can get something to drink if you have to. Also, I always encourage teachers to keep some kind of snack in a box. Now, the reason I say a snack is not because you want to feed the kids. You're not going to get hungry. But several years ago, when I was working for a corner drugstore, I was assigned to Joyce Bullock Elementary, and I was in a classroom. And they did their school lockdown. But they decided that they would test the teachers out and see why we're in a lockdown. If you pull the fire alarm, will anybody exit the building? So I'm in a small classroom with some class, and one of the children there was autistic. And so when they pulled the fire alarm, the sound just really made him go off the chain. And I happened to have a pack of those big 60 cookies. And so I just got him in the corner and called him, and I stood outside the door and I said, "Hey, buddy, eat a cookie." So he eat on the cookie, and they calm him down. And it's not necessarily to keep the kids fed, but it's a tool that the teachers can use for kids that have special needs to kind of calm their fears and put them back in a normal state the best they can. So I encourage them to keep some kind of food in there. We have, it's a hand sanitizer, disinfectant wipes, Lysol, trash bags, and things like that. Also this summer, I took a course in Orlando, Mr. Weber was there, and it was the guy in there, he said, you know, schools are on limited budgets. The teachers obviously try to supply stuff in their own classroom. If as a teacher, you tried to put a first aid kit in your room, it's $100+ for a first aid kit. He said, I'm going to give you some suggestions of things you can use in case of a major situation. He's an S-plus for a major situation. So he had 4 items in a little kit he had. He said, you're going to need something for a tourniquet. He said, you could buy those little cheap tourniquets off like Amazon. And so I found, I think, a pack of 6 for like $3. It's just a small tourniquet, but you can use if you need it. So we encourage teachers to purchase this or use a extension cord, electric cord, whatever. Use your
use your sleeve, your shirt, whatever, but have something to do with tourniquet. Also, you need something for some kind of coagulant to make the bleeding stop. So they encourage to use packets of sugar. A major bleed, but sugar won't stop. But if you have a bleed that's not like a gusher, you can slow down the bleeding with sugar. It'll actually make the blood coagulate. It says you have a child that's been shot. Insert a tampon. Insert a tampon into the bullet hole. It will do the job as a pressure bandage. But you have to insert it in the hole. And lastly, he said for a sucking chest wound, just use a maxi bag. Because it does the same job. It allows you to breathe out, and breathe in, it pulls to your skin, and allows your lung to function properly. So he said, those are just small things you can put in a classroom that a teacher can afford to put in there. Now, through the course of this idea of talking things, Mr. Aswell came out of school one day with the fire department. They brought us these handy dandy little things to put on the arms of our doors. So you put it over the hinge of the door and you try to open the door. It doesn't open. So it's just another deterrent. So the fire department from Bronson brought these, which we're very grateful for. But while they were there, we were discussing the bucket process. So Mr. Aswell said, hey, I've got some contacts. He contacted a friend at Lowe's, and Lowe's, to this point, has provided 30 buckets free of charge for Bronsonville High School. A parent came to the school the other day, and she said, hey, I gave those buckets to Mr. Aswell. Do you need any more? I said, well, use 15 more if you got them. She said, we'll try to make it happen. So with the help of the community, the people in the community, we're going to try to put these buckets in every classroom. So we've got enough to start our bucket list with. Now we have to find supplies to put it in there. My wife's mother works for Meridian, and there she's trying to get some stuff donated from Meridian that we can put in first aid kits to help out. So through donors and through, you know, people in the community that are supporting us, hopefully, before too long, we'll have this bucket full for every classroom. So every classroom in Bronson Middle High School will have a bucket, supplies to get them through a day if they need it, you know, in this situation, which hopefully never do. If so, we'd like to be prepared.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
What is the pool noodle for?
The pool noodle is actually you cut it and you set it around the rim of the toilet. It's a cushion.
Make it a toilet seat.
It's just like a toilet seat, you just put it around the rim. It's very...
You never took your wife fishing?
It's a lot more comfortable than sitting on that, trust me.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
I hope we have lots of those and never, ever have a few.
I will.
All right, we'll move on to our district facilities committee. Mr. Lott, good morning.
As you know, we have been in the process of hopefully securing the special facilities funding for a new project in Chiefland Middle High School. And as part of that process, there are a lot of things that are in the works, and we meet on a fairly regular basis with our facilities consultant, Mr. Gene Tanner. And out of one of those meetings, probably three weeks ago now, he suggested that we form a district educational facilities committee, even though that particular thing was not in statute as far as school facilities. He said that it has is becoming a part of the special facilities funding process. So we met with him again yesterday, actually. In the meantime, I reached out to our schools. I got some input from the schools that I asked them to make contact with different people in their communities to see who might be a good representative for each one of our communities. And as you can see, these are the nominees. We've contacted those nominees, and they have generously accepted the invitation to be a part of that committee. John Meeks from Bronson, Osmond Barker from Chiefland, Desiree Mills from Williston, Ted Alexander from Cedar Key, and Diana Pearson from Yankton. So at this time, we're asking Board approval for the creation of this committee and also approval of the nominees that we've made.
Sir. I have a motion to approve.
Sorry. Motion to second. Do y'all have any questions?
No, I mean, it's mandated by the state that we have a
recommended.
Recommended, okay.
The
It's recommended in regard to requesting the special facilities funding. It's another layer of public input and really kind of oversight in regards to security funds.
No further questions. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Lott. Ms. Lake.
Good morning. I want to talk about something that you'll see in the consent agenda, but the superintendent asked me to explain it. So last board meeting, we approved the annual financial report. So within 24 hours, we realized we had an auditor call us. These reports, there's three separate spreadsheets. You have to open them in a certain order to maintain the integrity of the information between each spreadsheet. We believe one of them got opened incorrectly during the upload and it corrupted another one. So essentially what it did is it took a major fund and called it a non-major fund. So it changed an M to an N. The MD&A, it's important to note that in the MD&A we had it specified as a major fund. We identified it. That was all correct. Literally in the upload it changed that information, which then caused two other spreadsheets to react to that. So the auditor called us, notified us, we corrected it, we sent it back to DOE, corrected the justification, DOE accepted it. But what you're going to do is pre-approve the updated or amended version. Since the auditor did catch it, even though it was the next day, we don't know the impact, if there will be a note on the audit for the AFR. But no dollars, no amounts changed. It was literally, it just took a fund, a major fund, and changed it to a non. Does anybody have any questions?
That system, is this our system or a state system?
No, it's a state system. They give us three spreadsheets and you have to open them in a specific order. And then you have to upload them the same way. So the documents we had were correct. So what we printed out was correct. So we can only guess that the upload is where it was incorrect.
Just for all, our numbers are correct, their system. Because of the glitch that it has. I would be interested if we get a note.
Which we might because the auditor caught it. And Ms. Kroll even talked to the auditor. And you can see where the MD&A notes where we say that the debt service is a major fund. But you'll see on the N, literally this N was an N instead of an M. And then whatever it was linked to in the other spreadsheets caused some things to change. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we'll now move to our public hearing on the legislative platform. Chris.
I've emailed out to you and in your packet are the two items. And one is the items that y'all identified last year for your legislative platform. And also I've included to a draft of the UFEC. Their legislative platform on the ballot pass and stuff from the Florida School Board Association. And right now, if they start talking and developing a list of for your priorities for this year.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
The five things that came out of last week's meeting at the Mississippi for the state legislative. The first item is bulleted under school safety, and it's to increase recurring operational funds that provide school districts local flexibility to hire at least one law enforcement officer, school safety officer, guardian at each school and or so, and to implement local school, safe school initiatives. And there's going to be a little bit of tweaking of the word spending on things here, so this is kind of a framework. And along with that, increase the funding to FDOE for Safe Schools Facility Grant Program in order for more schools in Florida to be hardened for safety. Expand the allowable uses of the grant program to include emergency shelter renovations. So that's the first thing. Mental health is the second bullet. It's to build upon the investment made last year for mental health services by providing funding to hire additional school counselors. To expand and enhance mental health services available through school and community coordinated services to provide enhanced wraparound services. The last two items is one deals with personnel, and I thought this was something Obviously, we've seen here with the district, authorized school districts to reemploy without FRS pension penalty, school-based administrators, teachers, substitute teachers, and other instructional support personnel after 1 month of retirement. So basically, we have a person like Danny Campbell, best of his, they don't volunteer for a year because they went through drop. Now we rehire them back like we did this year. That person will be able to be retired for a month and then reemploy those highly effective teachers, administrators, keeping them in our pool. So, and then the last thing deals with funding. It's to restore the full value of the required local effort village rate, as was the historical practice prior to 2016, to capture increases in property value and revenue gained from new construction. So.
And one of the things in the NEPAC platform talks about is restoration of 2 mills, the way it used to be. But if they do so, they have that extra half mill where it goes to where it fit. Their platform talks about hardening efforts, but there's just capital outlay for that.
The 2 mil was discussed with current leadership. I think things will be a little bit relaxed, but you know when Kim echoed this at that meeting on Thursday, probably not going to be an appetite to have that 2 mil. So, continue talking about that, but it's not going to be only this year. Maybe one of those continuing a couple of years. So, and I think also with the uncertainty, if anybody tells you that they know who's going to be the governor come November, I think as we've seen here locally, that if you're wrong, you must have a much better crystal ball. So I think that's another thing that's kind of weighing in on this.
One of the other things that's kind of a topic at the NEPAC, and I brought it up to you, is the teacher certification exam is strengthened. And so therefore, I know this year there were over 1,000 folks that lost their job in statewide. And to see if we can put some contingencies in there such that we can locally certify these folks. One of the things that I think we need to be cautious about, there's 3 parts to the exam. There's a general knowledge test, and there's 2 subject area parts. And certainly if you're a math teacher, you want to be able to pass the math part, I would think. So some sort of qualification in there, a conversation with Kim and Google, if that's something we should choose to do for the lobby for, some sort of qualification, not just to have a local certification only, but to have some sort of qualification in there for assurance of quality, let's say, assurance of content.
Yes, sir.
What were you reading from?
That's our Florida School Boards Association, the state association, so that'll be their platform. Some of those.
That's not in here.
Sir?
That's not in the agenda.
No, sir. So, but I mean, it's as soon as it is typed up and I can link it to something, I would be happy to forward that to you. So, I mean, I can, if you go to floridaschoolboard.org, those items are under the proposed legislative platform. And like I said, there will be a little bit of kind of tweaking of the verbiage on it, but it's 1A and B. Number 2, number 8, and number 15. These are out of, I think there was like 28 proposals that were submitted from Pensacola and Key West, so by school districts. So those 5 that I just told will be the finalized version that was voted on last Thursday by this legislative committee. So I think we had, unfortunately, not great numbers, but it's about what we have for a primary turnaround. We had 25 of 67 districts represented there.
And Chris represents our board for the Florida School Board Association, so he wants to come in.
Any
Those are also going to be brought up, Chris, too, at our meeting in December.
They'll be, right, this will be presented at the State School Board Association meeting. It's November 3rd, 27th is the first, I think, so.
Are these still proposed, are they?
Well, these are the ones from last year that the board identified.
Are from last?
Yes, sir.
We're still working on our.
That's what they're being here today.
Right.
Do they have a legislative sessions, a legislative delegation meeting set up yet? Here locally?
I haven't seen anything on that, about our legislative, not here, so. Session is a little bit later this year, because there's, elections will be over, so they don't have to rush out. So it, I think we start, I know our school board's legislative day is in April, so. But I know this board is going to be going up earlier in the process, so, and I think that's one of the little things that we're sitting here trying to do. You know, I realize probably this morning meeting, so we're not going to be able to get many people, but trying to still continue to get out the word out there, to have people to have input on this, and go through the process, so we can have our Levy County School Board legislative platform.
Yes, sir.
We talked generally, we're getting the weeds some with, like, number two in the EOC, because we've had that discussion, and I think the appetite's not that the uniform across the state. I don't think we're getting anywhere there.
No.
Should we change that where our goal, or should I say this? I guess my opinion would be to change that we end the EOC.
That would be my recommendation. They're not going to, in my opinion, there's two areas that, or one in the course exam, are not going to get rid of, and that's the algebra one, because that is a graduation requirement. But based upon the feedback that I believe we received, I think the best thing to do is to get rid of the state EOCs and let the teachers give the grades for those courses. But they're still going, because it is a mandatory graduation requirement, algebra one is, passing that, you're not going to get rid of that test. So, other than that, we're just. I'm trying to link to the website, and one of the things is we put out there an email soliciting for comments, and to my knowledge, I haven't had any response yet.
I think we don't need to go up there with 12 or 13 things. I think we need to keep concentrated like we've been with three or four things.
Yeah, these are the 13 things y'all identified last year.
I further believe, it sounds crass, it sounds terrible. It's not meant to be crass or terrible. School safety is going to work. School safety doesn't need Levy County pushing school safety. That's like I said about reading the blind kids, that's easy. We want kids safe, and there's nobody's going to fight against that. So I don't think that should be what we go up there beating on. I think y'all know that myself and Dr. Hall are prepared to beat through that wall for classroom accommodations on tests, whatever it takes. So you know that's where my heart lies. I think we also need to concentrate on our Chicken High School project. I think based on what you're saying, we do need to keep pushing on EOC to get rid of the EOC. We know we're going to have the odds for EOC, but the rest of them, come on. And I think all that feeds back to number four. I think we got to somehow get word in there that we want to go back to a little bit more home rule. For too long, Tallahassee believes this state is made up of all the same people from Pensacola to Miami, and they're not. Every little section of Florida is a little different. And people in Tallahassee don't know best how to educate the children of Levy County. I think the people of Levy County know how to educate their children and what their needs are. Those are my thoughts, in just looking quickly.
That's a home rules of.
That's a big umbrella.
But I mean, we have state senators and leaders who are going up in leadership that absolutely have no idea the way things happen in our small rural counties. And comments like, your raises come from your local leadership. And has no idea, and won't tell that we get a 47 cent increase per student in allocation. Anyway, I don't think we could ever lose that home. That's the, that is for us in that big umbrella, a lot of what we're talking about.
Right, that home rule affects all this other stuff.
And I neglected, there was one thing also that was on there, number 16 on the document, so, and that's to increase the base student allocation. And we added a dollar figure to that, and I was during the meeting frantically texting back this late because I know the school finance officers, you might, would you share the figure that they, that your school finance, I'm sorry, I'm putting you on the spot here, so, but anyways, we did a 3% increase, but then we allowed staff to go back and look at a historical record on the last 5 years.
They're wanting to see a $281.84, which is about almost a 7% increase, but they propose to stay.
And the problem you get into a lot of things is they increase your base student allocation, but it's categorically increased.
And that was, and we, that was part of it in making sure that it wasn't part of restricted funding. So, and that's the thing to look at. Mr. Etheridge is absolutely correct in that you back out categoricals, your unrestricted funding is 47 cents per kilo. And Mr. Terry, I don't know about you, but if you looked from today to a year ago, I'm sure your electric bill, you kind of figured it up, has gone up. And to cover for 5,500 students in Davie County, that's about $2,500 across the district, an increase in unrestricted funding. And it's real easy to look back, because we have, when you count school safety, when you count mental health, it looks very good in the categoricals. When you add those categoricals in, it's hard for them to say that they think we're complaining, and we're not complaining. It's trying to get them to understand, to take back, and look at that 30,000 view to see it costs more than 47 cents to keep maintain buildings when your PICO funding has not increased, when your health insurance costs are going up. All the things that go into this, we don't have enough money to buy all the textbooks. When you look at what was our allocation on textbook allocation?
So $400,000.
$400,000. So, and all it takes is one science textbook adoption, and we have wisely spent all of that, and then some out of general revenue. And you look at people right here, the people in our classrooms, the people that are driving our buses, there's no doubt that every single one of us sitting here wants to be able to help, to offer them raises and things like that, and do right by our leadership. We've had the expense of the increase in the funding of SROs, and this is no knock on the county commissioners, the sheriff, or anything like this. They have been great partners. But when you look at what that cost, those are dollars that are not being spent on educating students, and that's our job.
I definitely am slipping on our priorities. The base allocation without the restrictions.
Okay.
Well, I can tell you this board is advocating to support our staffs. And it is disheartening when you meet somebody from Tallahassee and they tell you about how much money is in the budget and how much money you're getting, but yet we cannot do anything about it. Substantially. That Tallahassee is pushing the property for.
I think there will be an appetite, at least for sure, for the Senate side. Senator Bradley was talking about the yard. So I think he equates it. I've heard him use this before, and I'll say it, you know, if Mr. Laney goes today and buys a lawnmower and rate is 6.5%. If in 6 months I go and that lawnmower now costs $350, my tax rate did not increase. Yes, the taxes are more, but it's because that lawnmower now costs more. And so that's not a tax increase. So that's the value of the lawnmower has gone up. So I think there will be an appetite, at least from the Senate side, that we can gain traction that will help with this process. The House side is a little bit of unknown. I'm not familiar with the new incoming speaker, so it's out of my hand. It will be better, but so the one good thing is the two appropriations chair is Bradley from the Senate side and Travis Cummings from Flagler. So I really hope before we have legislative days, I know how important this Chief Lund project is. Hopefully getting Representative Stone, I know he's coming over on October 2nd, and getting Senator Bradley into the district. Just taking him around and showing how well we do, continuing a good fight and doing God's work for our kids. So, on the resources that we're out here, so I think that would be a really good, strong.
So, Chris, how can we go about inviting and making sure that we get him to this area, and what can we do to help him? How can we make that happen?
I think we're probably going to have to go to him first, sit down with him, and then work on it. So I know he's been invited to the Beast Feast, so but I think one of the good things about both of our legislators is the fact that we can have good dialogue, and we may be not on the same side on an issue, but we can kind of work our way to get to the middle, to get agreement, and to do what's right for our kids. And that's all the kids, whether it's the 11 districts, the Senator Bradley, or the two districts, the Representative Stone. We're going to have to work at it to get him, so he's in Orange Park. That's difficult, and I know it's very difficult to get just a one-on-one with him because he has 11 counties that he represents. So we just have to continue. And I know there's some stuff going on behind the scenes to work on that. So I'll pause for that.
I'll talk with you.
Yes, sir. They don't have legislative delegation. They have other ones.
Facebook is all important.
Yes, yes.
I wanted to ask you about school safety and
the wording is not great, but let's face facts. Everybody in the state wants their kids safe. And with the Florida School Boards Association pushing that, we back that 100%. And what we need to do is we need to concentrate on our issues. And our issues, we know that they're going to fund school safety. You know it. I mean, it goes without saying. We want children safe, so that's going to happen. That doesn't need us pressing hard. What needs us pressing hard is home. What needs us pressing hard is accommodation. What needs us pressing hard is the Chief Lund Middle High School project. That needs us pushing hard. But we need to be in support of the school safety. But pushing hard, we need these things that are priority to lead county.
So you're short on, you were short on school resource officer funding this year. And I know the county commission's going to go full court press to get more funding for that. Shouldn't you be doing the same thing?
Well, you are.
That was a big deal.
We will be.
You were short on school resource funding, really. You know, you got more from this that you didn't do now.
And
that's the point I was trying to
make. Well, and if you really study it, that's a microcosm of the whole thing. We run short all the time on every line item. We run short, so we're used to pushing for that. So this is not breaking up mold. We're going to keep pushing. I'm saying these are extra pushes.
I think what Mr. Rasko is trying to say is that
the school safety in Levy County is no different than any other district as far as the school resource officer funding or anybody else. And I can say that FADS, Federal Florida School Superintendent's Association, the Florida School Boards Association, LEFAC, that consortium, all of these entities, these larger entities, are going to be pushing to fully fund the school safety programs and initiatives that are started out there, whether it's school resource officers, whether it's the guardian program, whether it's the counselors and the psychologists in the schools, and fully funding those initiatives and not taking money back.
Levy part of that?
Yeah. So you have all of these big organizations that are going to be doing that, and we'll be part of that effort as well.
As long as you don't just lay back and say, well, somebody else is going to do it.
No, that is not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, we're going to support these others in their push, but this is our push right here. And we push that constantly. We push those issues constantly. So it's not, like I said, it's not breaking the mold. We've been pushing school safety issues for 10 years that I know of.
So the rural track today, we are working on Levy County's legislative platform. We're trying to establish the top 3, 4, 5 things that are unique to our county.
To our county.
Specifically, we work on the towns.
And what y'all did last time is y'all identified 13 different items, and out of those 13 different items, we'll probably miss them now.
We only have so much political capital. And so you can see number one right there, that Chief of Little High School. That's a large ask. And understanding, you know, the other thing that the perception is that school boards, superintendents, that we're always with our hand out like this. And that's, so I think that's another reason why, knowing that the state association is really pushing this and has the capital to go with that, because it's such a broad subject, we can be laser focused into what can really, really be effective. And that's our goal in developing our legislative.
And it has worked, being focused on those three topics and three issues. When we go up there, we've been so much more effective than we have been, you know, so broad. So I'm really in support of that and just kind of channeling it to our three basic things. And then also, do we have a date that we're going to go this year, or are we planning on going in January before our school board dates? We've discussed that, but what we're leaning towards before the end of the year or after January?
We're trying to see when the committee time is, and they'll be up there, so maybe you can reach out to Kim and ask her.
Yeah, what I hope to have is either Kim or representatives from our office at our next board meeting.
Oh, okay.
Because at the next board meeting, we're supposed to finalize this list. Because we need to get all this done. I think in my conversation with Kim, she's looking at January.
Yes, sir, Mr. Kerr.
Might want to consider adding either as a footnote or an asterisk down there so that no one will think that the county is not interested in safe school and things, and maybe not have it one of our priorities. But let's have either an asterisk or a footnote down at the bottom of those says Levy County supports the FADS, the FSBA, and anybody in LEFAC in their endeavors regarding safe school, something to that. I mean, that way no one can look at that and say, oh, well, Levy County doesn't even have safe school.
Right.
Just a thought.
Thank you, Rap. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And I'm going to rehash this again, but as I sit here thinking about 80% of the things that we bang our head against trying to educate our students in Levy County, probably if we could develop a conversation on home that were real world within our county, 80% of things we do, if we had a lump sum, which will probably never happen again in the state of Florida, but if there was a lump sum money came to Levy County, our kids are tested, and we're monitored, and everything else is, to make sure we perform, we would have the ability to do things that we've never done before. Am I wrong?
You're correct.
Why can't we get a legislator who doesn't want top-down approach from Washington, the Florida legislature, to have the same concept at a local level? If it goes wrong, you have Liberty County, right? Or Jefferson County.
Yes, sir.
If it goes wrong, you have Jefferson County. We're monitored all the time from an academic standpoint, financial standpoint. Why can't they let local control happen?
Because they have to give up.
We can say that, but in individual circumstances and actually the way our budget works within our county and what we actually have after our budget's done, that is discretionary within this county. I mean, it's not the same as Miami.
And I can tell you from our standpoint, when I say our, I'm talking about the district and schools and things that we have to do, one of the things that's on the list here that is the most frustrating thing to us, and I know it will change, I don't know what it will change to, but certainly there's going to be a new governor, so there's going to be a new climate, and I don't know what that climate will be. But right now, the current thing is you ask DOE advice, and they tell you, you go look at the statute, you interpret it, and then the officers will come in and tell you how wrong you did. And then they tell you to pay back on the money.
Because DOE had a different interpretation.
Correct. But they won't tell you, they won't. You ask for advice, they won't give you that advice, but they'll audit it and they tell you how wrong you were.
A perfect example is when we were at our meeting. Could you provide us with the list of the accommodations that are accepted? Oh, no, that's on an individual basis.
You need to call us.
You need to call us and submit, and we'll let you know. We're not trying to reinvent the wheel. We know there's accommodations that are out there that are acceptable that are in other districts. So, you know, this isn't the formula for a nuclear bomb. This is educating a child. So, you know, so something that may be going on in another district that would be successful for one of our kids, why would you not share something like that?
So they're saying it's on a district basis?
Individual child.
Yes, Dr. Hall, what was the comment was, submit the accommodation that you're talking about, so.
Your specific accommodations you were considering.
But there is no magic list.
And once again, this ties back into home rule, because, so we have kids that are using an accommodation that are helping them be successful, that are going from being students that hate school, don't do well, to students that are being successful, A, B students, and then it becomes time, something, going back to a piece of paper with three boxes on it, that doesn't change the validity of a test for you to take a sheet of paper and to have. That on it? That does not change the validity of a test. The knowledge that that student has in their head is still there.
Yes.
I was just going to say, I have seen this concept used in other statutes and so forth of having a safe harbor. If the district reaches out for some guidance, then that kind of protects them from negative audit coming. If we can document, maybe what we could be asking the state to specifically change is, look, we've reached out to DOE or state agency for some guidance on an issue, and we weren't able to provide it. Right. So that at least gives us a safe harbor kind of protection from a negative audit finding until that guidance is final. Because we can show that in good faith, we try to get right before there was a problem. So that might be a way to talk about it. We look for a safe harbor.
That's not the way it is right now.
Absolutely.
But we would be covering ourselves.
We tried that with Best and Brightest. I have to tell you, we tried getting advice ahead of time, and they would give us none.
But then they came back and said you did it
wrong. The auditor's costs.
That's a concept I think legislature is literally familiar with. Maybe that's what we're asking.
Anything else?
I think it's an order of importance.
I think that list right there is just how they came up. And then we figured each three. Actually, I can't remember.
All right, that's the list of items that the board generated last year. And then from that, they identified three items.
last year, when we went up there, we did the 30% EOC, the student accommodation, and the safe schools. That's what we talked about last year. Right, that we chose number two, number three, and number six, number seven.
We chose number three and seven, but they also added on number two when they were up.
Now, will we have another, we're going to have another workshop?
Yes, sir, at the next board meeting, we'll have a workshop, and hopefully we'll identify the items.
That'll be a nightly.
Yes, sir.
Good opportunity for people to be here. Got it. All right, we'll move on. Has everyone had a chance to read over the minutes of the last meeting? Are there any changes or corrections?
I have a motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Now we'll move to our consent agenda. Are there any changes to the consent or the additions to?
The consent agenda, page four. Need to delete Constant Ward from the outer field. Page five, delete Sherry Schuler from Lewisville High outer field. Constance Ward, delete from outer field. And page six, personally, Crystal Lindley is office patient supports.
That it?
That's it.
Mr. Gower, you have any questions?
Most of mine have been answered, so I'm good to answer.
Mrs. Brooke?
No, I think they've all been answered. Thank you so much.
Mr. Turner?
Questions?
I'm not going to.
I was going to say, is that in?
Yeah, I think mine's pretty simple, but as I was going through the finance budgetary items, but I did see where we had budgeted about $220,000 for new school buses. When do we order new?
Actually, $500. The $200 is our debt service payment for buses we leave, but we have like $550 in our capital budget for the new school buses. Have we ordered the five new school buses?
Yes, I believe we ordered them. We may look to possibly, the prices may increase in December. We may look at where we're at for next year by December.
How many buses are in the fleet?
We're running 55 routes. We have 82 buses. And then we have the eight sitting on the line to sell.
So you're selling 10% and placing the five new buses you ordered? That's all the questions I have.
Thanks. I do not have a question. I have a statement. Number nine, consent agenda, Linda Sheffield. Sheffield was a bus driver and substitute teacher when I was in school over 30 years ago. She's one of those people who's always been there at Bronson High School. And it's not until somebody's not there that you really realize how much they did, how much you miss them. They never hit me until we went to the football game this past week. Miss Sheffield taking a ticket and walking up and going, "Hey, Miss Sheffield." I had a stranger. It's kind of a weird feeling. But she did a great job. And the person wasn't a stranger, but Miss Sheffield. She did a great job for a lot of years for Lee County due to health reasons. She's gone with her family in Louisiana. And she was a grand marshal of our homecoming parade last week. And it was neat to get to ride with her and hear people say, "I love you, Miss Sheffield." So that tells you a lot about that lady. I'm going to miss her very much, very much. If there are no further comments or questions, I will entertain a motion to adopt the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried. Mr. Superintendent.
Mainly, what I've got to talk about today are some things that have been coming your way. And we shared with you some draft of some core values here some time back. And I know Ms. Hires has been working hard with the schools and communicating back and forth and getting feedback and stuff. So I hope that we're going to have that soon, very soon, to come to you for approval and adoption. Okay. Second thing is something we've been looking at for years, is, and it's a problem that we have, is substitutes. Okay?
And there are different services that are out there. The most prevalent service out there is teleservices. And it's where they actually employ substitutes and they provide the substitutes for us. Currently, how the thing is, we have substitutes and then we have a staff member have to call and somebody else, the staff member has to do that. We believe that we're in a position now where we can actually, there's more vendors are out there that provide these services. And so we're actually going to probably put together a proposal for you to approve to go out and request for a quote for bid or whatever the correct terminology is for that and from these three vendors. And I believe that'll be something that's very good. They have a very good success rate. One of the benefits for it is that the substitutes are actually employees, whereas currently right now the substitutes are not employees. So that would be good because they get benefits and stuff too. Do you want to make any comments on that? Kim or Marla?
I would say that the need that HR directors, as we talked about some of these vendors, we said that they had a 98% bill rate. What happens on a school campus is when you can't fill a classroom with a sub, you end up pulling a para to go in there. And last year we had a huge rate of paras that never even got to hardly do their ESOL or their ESE support. They were pulled from all these different places to fill in for teachers or subs that could not be replaced. So what this will do is actually help support the teacher with these aides staying in their place, doing interventions, working with these students that need extra help. And this, I think we will see a tremendous difference in our classrooms, the morale of our teachers, the morale of our subs. I think this could be a very valuable tool.
From the finance, it gives us access to a larger pool to choose from. But there are overhead costs associated with the subs we have now. We print paper checks if they don't have direct deposit. We process payroll, we do fingerprints, we do background checks. There's a liability associated that we carry. All of that will now shift to this temporary, to this staffing agency. We will pay an increase. We're looking at somewhere around 15% to 30%. We have two that we're looking at right now, so that would be on top of what we pay their salary. But there is a reduction to some of our staff now that have to focus on subs, from processing them to paying them to coordinating them at a school level, which has become very difficult and burdensome on those frontline secretaries. They start at like 4 or 5 a.m. sometimes calling in subs.
The bottom line is we believe our kids deserve.
Would we also look at our bus, are we still short on bus drivers and aides, or are we good on that?
No, we're not short.
Not short.
Okay. So if we do a program like this, what about the subs we already have?
They will go into the...
Go into that pot?
Yes, sir. And can I say another advantage is that these subs, when they're contracted by this vendor, they can work 5 days a week, summers, holidays. They're not just filling in for the classroom teacher. This company can use them to sub in other companies, and they can actually make a lot more money and be much happier because they can work 5 days a week if they want to. And this company, a couple of these companies, they offer gift cards, they offer drawings, they recruit from our local football games, basketball games. In our communities, they're out and about getting to know these people. And
it sounds
like a pretty amazing opportunity.
And I've got to put my principal hat on. Every time I found a good sub, I got a job somewhere else. And so it's a while to keep up good subs.
Is that what happened, Ken Blake?
Yes, actually, I did start as a sub. I just wanted to work a little bit.
Right, and you just got full time.
I did.
So that'll be coming to you. Also, I'm going to be giving this to this is a memorandum of understanding for emergency counseling services, and I'll talk to Dr. Hall about this, and also probably we'll reach out to our neighboring counties on the east and the south and the northeast of us. But working with our small, when you have emergencies in our other counties, for us to get together and be able to have a MOU and share any services, because we can't do it all by ourselves. And secondly, I spoke with y'all sometime back about the need to do this. And right now we're in the middle of district accreditation. The accreditation visit will be here the week of the 22nd of October. And our team is working feverishly to upload the documents and do the things we need to do. But within this, I know one of the things that we're out of compliance in is our strategic plan. And I'm finally, I think, getting to the point where I believe the district accreditation process will lead us in a good position to really develop a good strategic plan. I sent in on a presentation of how one district is doing this, and I really like it because it involves you. And you're a part of a strategic plan or a part of different goals on the strategic plan. You're a board member would take a category or be part of the category. And but it's a process. A lot of school districts, especially smaller ones, what essentially will happen is the superintendent or staff will say, this is what we're working on, and throw it to you, and they'll approve it, and that's what the strategic plan. But I believe a good process that we continually work on, not a plan that we agree on paper that gets put on the shelf, but a good way of work, and the things that we identify as a board, work on, this is what we want to improve and how we want to do it, and how you're going to allocate resources and support those processes. And I think that would be a good thing to do. And we all have different strengths and areas. And hopefully I'll be bringing this to you in a recommendation as soon as the process is over. Let's start. Comments on that?
When was the last time a strategic plan was real?
7 years ago. It was done right before the last accreditation cycle. No, sir.
All right, we'll move on.
Don't have anything to do.
All right, we'll move to board comments. I'll start with you, Mr. Ed.
I don't have a lot of comments. Seems like the patient running very smoothly. Get a lot of feedback from the community over our area, excited about school. And you can go a whole week as a school board member and not get a phone call about an issue things are going through with. So sometimes no news is good news, and that's all I
know. I'll let you know when that happens.
I'll remember this because I tried to call you yesterday in the mailbox as well, so I figured it was full up.
That was business related.
Donating things and all kind of good things that they're donating for the issue from high school. Was reported to me that 21 students are in full enrollment at the school, and that they're getting ready for an ACT boot camp. And then we have homecoming, which is, they're open this week, and homecoming is next Friday, the 5th of October, and we'll be, I'm having a homecoming parade, and she was, we're doing great. Adam Gore, our coach, talked to us the other day at Rotary, and it's just, it's great to hear the positive things that he says, you know, about the kids and that he's doing, and Adam's come a long way too. Don't you think, Mr. Edison too, and just the changes and the great things that he's doing, it's wonderful to hear. I was thrilled, you know, and I'm not, I don't know all the football terms, but it was really good.
Well, that's one of the things that, you know, again, if you're in the board, and you, nothing, I'm not taking anything away from that.
Right.
He's done a pretty good job with kids.
Yeah.
But the recognition that of the value of extracurricular activities, and the board adopting that plan, and that's one of the things Dennis Weber's working on throughout the schools, is working on, and the importance that these activities have in the lives of our children, and the importance these people have in the lives of our children. I mean, if you look back, when we went to school, yes, ABCs and 1-2-3s are important, but the motivating drivers, or a lot of things, are not academic, and they supplement and they support the academic. And so that has been the emphasis this board has made, and I commend you on that. And you know, I believe when we do our strategic plan, that is something that we're looking at.
And I think that's great, and continuing, and not just even on report on Chief One, it's just, it's all the schools and the great things that they're doing. So it's very important. That's all I have. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. I want to thank Mr. Turner for his comments. So, and I'm just going to speak for myself. I appreciate Ms. Brookins, Mr. Turner, Ms. Philpott. Whenever I came on this board, and Mr. Aswell's DVI. So, just as a new board member coming in and just kind of developing a relationship, you know, you may not have been someone where we were acquaintances or things like that. So, just appreciate that. So I hope everybody knows I'm thankful of that. So I've been fortunate for 6 years, and I've been doing the same thing and continuing. So I know there's some things that processes that they want more, so I appreciate that, Mr. Chair. So October 20th, Beast Feast. So mark it on your calendar. So what doesn't happen will be at Anthrich Produce Packing Shed. So you can get anything from frog legs, to clam chowder, to gumbo, to clams, to kind of everything in between, and some good desserts too. And then there'll be a cake option. It's limited. I think there's about 12 to 15 cakes, and the money raised from those cakes goes to a literacy project, providing up to $75 in classroom and $35 for our beginning teachers up to 2 years. So, trying to help them develop their classroom libraries, so that means using money for that. Also during that weekend, full seafood festival, so come to Cedar Key. So you can buy a hamburger from PTO, or clam fritters from the junior class, or anything else in between. So funnel cakes, and, you know, it's one of those things that it just is amazing. All of our schools, whether it's a carnival this week at Chiefland Elementary, how important those things are for our schools, and how for the community and the involvement. So I sure appreciate all the involvement. This afternoon, I know at 2:45, we'll be at Yankee Town, and we'll be there before then, but there's going to be a little reception. Have an outpouring of applications for our school foundation, NICE grants, and grants for great ideas in Yankee Town. Awarding some lucky teachers dollars to help them educate our students, take them on field trips, provide some supplies for the classrooms, and everything in between. So we had a pretty good mix between all of throughout the county on those. So that was a nice thing. So, and that's everything that I have.
Thank you, sir. Lane, you have? The only thing I always
The Bronson FFA chapter sponsoring a fishing tournament October 13th. If you're interested in being a sponsor, those sponsorship opportunities are available. It's a great advertisement, and that is due on October 1st, but you can sign up, be in the tournament all the way till the day of. Captain's meeting will be on the 11th at Bronson Middle High School cafeteria. Say, Chief is having an ACT boot camp. Who's running that? Where'd she go to school at?
She went to
Where'd she get that main education? That's Bronson. All right, so anyway, that's another story for another day. Notice Jonathan is back here. If he wouldn't mind, could you please introduce yourself to everyone and tell us what you're doing? How many counselors you have in your school?
Jonathan Lewis with the Levy County Prevention Board. We focus on substance abuse prevention, mental health promotion. We have kind of an organization that is married to, in a way, CDS, used to be Corner Drug Store, but collaboratively we have around eight counselors throughout the county, some that serve as two different drugs counselors in elementary schools. Our students see them once a week, every week, just like they would use it for PE. That also, two different violence is included in that, so they receive both substance use prevention and conflict resolution skills for up through fifth grade. And then we have family action counselors that focus on truant students or ungovernable. We try to make sure that's approached a little bit differently than other counseling, where we try to go to the student instead of asking them to come to us. And we have offices and all over. We usually always travel to them. And then we, of course, have environmental strategies that we've done Friday night and Friday night. We're youth to spend there Friday night the right way without drugs and alcohol. We're really pushing that in Williston. This year, I met with Chief Lund just last week. We're going to try to get that going there as well. And we have the Natural High campaign, which is encouraging youth to find their natural high instead of drug or alcohol. And if they start feeling stressed or whatever it may be, do something positive, sports, music, art, that type of stuff. And so with that, we'll begin here shortly in Bronson.
Y'all, where are you from?
The Levy County Prevention.
Yeah, where'd you go to school at?
Oh, Phillips.
Okay. So one out of
you thought you had a leg.
Anyway, thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, SRO Osteen. We appreciate all of your day. And if there are no further comments or questions, the meeting is adjourned.